This is a first interview, video interview with Ron Bartek, president of the FARA, Friedrich Ataxia Research Alliance, which is the most important organization, okay, funding FA research. And as we met Ron Bartek here in Serbia at the Euro Ataxia meeting, but unfortunately yesterday we came late. We want to give our subscribers, our readers, our members the possibility of having a short summary from Ron Bartek about the presentation that he gave yesterday afternoon. So Ron, please, could you be so kind to give us a short interview for not longer than 9 minutes, 8 minutes regarding your presentation of yesterday, telling the most important points and possibly encouraging points regarding FA research.
Absolutely. John Piron, thank you very much for having me today. And it's a pleasure, as always, to collaborate between FARA and Babel Family, as we always do. And in fact, that's a good introduction for why I'm here. This is a very important time in the community of FA research. And it's unfortunately been a difficult year for all of our organizations for a number of reasons. One is that we had a failure this year in our first phase 3 clinical trial in FA of idebenone. It failed to meet its endpoints. We were all very hopeful that this might become our first approved treatment. It did not quite make that achievement. So we also have seen some discouragement because it's been a difficult year economically around the world. And so all of our organizations have had a little bit more of a challenge to raise the funds that we all need to do our work. But despite that encouragement, we know that the discouragement cannot prevail, because we not only must succeed in treating and curing Friedreich's ataxia, but we will succeed. And we'll succeed because we will do it together. No one of our organizations, not even our governments, could succeed in treating and curing Friedreich's ataxia by themselves. We must all do this together, as Babel Family and FARA have done from the beginning. And so we need to continue to support the research, and we will. And the third reason that we will succeed is that, and discouragement will not prevail, is the wonderful things that we are together helping fund, and that will cross the finish line. So I can go over the most promising aspects, yes, sure, of that research. And maybe we should break there and, yes, and move to the computer.
Yes, we're, yeah, okay. Okay, we're ready.
Okay. So just to list briefly the things that we're being able to accomplish together. First, we know that we've been able to grow the field, to grow the scientific field and the field of advocacy around the world. If you go back to when FARA was first created, back in 1998, we had our first international conference in spring of 1999. We went around the world looking for scientists interested in meeting with us for 3 days, and we found 65 scientists to add to the 15 at the NIH in Bethesda, Maryland. So we had a conference for 3 days with at the NIH with 80 scientists. Not a single drug company in the world was interested, and only one other advocacy organization. We did it again in 2003 and in 2006. To go to 2006, we had to refuse 30 scientists who wanted to participate to keep it at a manageable 150. There were 6 drug companies that not only participated but helped us pay for the conference. There were 6 other advocacy organizations that were already co-funding grants with us. So a marvelous growth in the field. Next year we'll do the 4th International Scientific Conference
in November,
ataxia in Strasbourg, France, mm-hmm, in May of 2011. And we will have probably 230 participants, and it will be held to that number only because of the size of the room. It could be much larger. So the field has grown in enthusiasm, in scientific understanding, in scientific enthusiasm, in the drug companies that continue to come to us to because they want to participate, and in the number of advocacy organizations that are cooperating to treat and cure Friedreich's ataxia. If you look at the grant funding that we've been able to muster around the world, FARA has been able to devote about, in its 12 years, $15 million to FA research. And because of the wonderful relationships we have with organizations like BabelFAmily and other advocacy organizations around the world, we've been able to, and with the governments around the world, we've been able to pull together about the same amount. So it's really twice 15 million. It's roughly $25 to $30 million that have been devoted to FA research in the last 12 years because of the kind of partnerships that all of our organizations have been able to form around the world.
Plus the $5 million from the European community.
The 6 million euros, yes, which is pretty close to $10 million. You add that, you have a phenomenal, and that money is mostly unspent. I mean, that's a brand new grant that we're thrilled about, and the collaborations with the European scientists are obviously the reason we're having the meeting in Strasbourg next year. The European scientists have always been the largest delegation to our
country. May I ask you something?
Yeah.
Is FARA going to collaborate with EFFECTS? I know that within EFFECTS there will be Repligen, you know, the company.
Right.
Okay, taking part in this project, very important European project. And what is the role of FARA in this EFFECTS?
FARA has always collaborated with the investigators, with the scientists that are now involved in EFACS, and we've collaborated on the clinical trials that EFACS has conducted and will conduct. For example, at next year's International Scientific Meeting in Strasbourg, we will have the overall community meeting Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and EFACS will have its meeting there on Sunday. All the EFACS participants will be there at our conference, and they'll have their own meeting the following day. So that's just the kind of collaborative nature that we're all using. And the clinical trials that are being run in EFACS are, you know, the results of those are being shared with our scientists in our collaborative clinical network. We have a similar network in the United States, Canada, and Australia. And when there's a drug that's coming along for clinical trial in the U.S., of course we get in touch with the people in EFACS and compare notes on trial design, on any of their findings. Quite often they have done some basic research on these drugs and in their animals. Let's take, for example, the HDAC inhibitor that we hope to get into clinical trial within the next few weeks. The HDAC inhibitor that was initially discovered at Scripps Research Institute in California by Joel Gottesfeld, then was licensed to Repligen. Repligen and Joel Gottesfeld had their HDAC inhibitors, as they were being designed, tested in the animal models, the mouse models, of Mark Pook in the UK and Massimo Pandolfo in Brussels. And the results instructed which HDAC inhibitor will be put in trial in our clinical network in the US. So there is absolute collaboration among EFACS scientists and the US, Australian, Canadian scientists from the beginning. I mean, from the basic science through the translational science through the clinical
science. And this would also guarantee that there will be no double work, I mean.
Oh, absolutely. There will be no
different laboratories, I mean.
Absolutely. There will be no redundancy.
Because in order not to
no duplication of effort.
Yes, and of money also.
Absolutely. Yeah. So
this is very important, losing time also.
All right. And in the same way that these scientists are collaborating, our advocacy organizations are collaborating. BabelFAmily and FARA and the Muscular Dystrophy Association
and so on.
FARA Australasia, Euroataxia, Ataxia UK, all the European, GoFAR, the Italian organization, ISA, who's organizing this meeting. So we're all in this together. This has changed from an FA experience.
Okay, now let's stop the first